starting with is kind of a, two different stories that emerged here in Kirkland. Back in 1876, Frank Christensen, actually his name was really Ferdinand Severin Christensen, but they hated the name Ferdinand, so everybody had to call him Frank, was born in Christensen, Norway, down the south of Norway. A few years later, 1886, Emily Svensson was born in Oslo. They were very close in areas for where they ended up in the world, they never met each other. Frank at the was around a seafaring family, and around the age of 10 got to go for his first whaling trip up into the Icelandic areas, and Spitsbergen, I think, is one of the areas up there in the far north, and didn't really work too seriously on whaling boats, but got interested in becoming a whaler. And as he grew older, he started working on whaling boats around the Norway area. Along the same time, Emily was growing up, and she was a oldest child of five, and this is a picture of Emily here. Her father ran the phone company outside of Oslo in a small town called Brunson. In this picture up here, and hopefully people walk by later and take a look at it, her grandfather's right here, her father is right here, and here's a picture of him when he was younger. In the middle of this group of men, there's a man in a deep sea diving outfit that used to have a big old hopper on the hood. And they would go into the water at Brunson and check the phone cables coming from the mainland from Oslo, walking along the bottom of the bay there, where they were to make sure everything was okay, there were problems at all. And so, when she was about 14, her mother passed away, and shortly thereafter, her father remarried. She'd been taking care of her siblings for a while her mother had been ill, and being a little bit rebellious and not excited about her new stepmother, she decided to run away to America. And so she was able to earn enough money to get passage on a ship. And these yarns I have read for her travels and green for Frank's travels. She got a ship in Oslo and sailed to New York, where she got a job as a maid for many years, and families around the Brooklyn area, I understand. And eventually she met a merchant seaman named Harold Oldenhauer, this dapper gentleman here standing on one of the ships he worked on. And they married when she was 26 and he was 29 years old. For some reason, they went down to Baltimore to marry. I'm assuming that perhaps his ship was more there or something, so they arranged that over here. The ship going back to Norway was leaving from there, so I found documentations of their marriage. My mother had sent away for it one time, just looking through her papers, I found a certificate confirming when they got married in Baltimore. So then I started puzzling my mind as to why they were there, and that's all I can assume is that then they went back to Norway from there. And a few years later, they had Emily and Harold had given birth to my mother, Erna Moldenhauer, and they lived in an apartment in Oslo. Around 1919, my mother was born in 1913, and in 1919, my grandfather Harold had met another lady on one of his many ship routes back and forth between Oslo and Norway, and he said he wanted a divorce, so he married this other lady, and Emily and Erna were then left on their own, and were staying with friends in a friend in Brunson. Here's a picture of my mother when she was four, gently, my mother's small and gone. And they lived there for a while until Emily's brother Ronvald had since moved from Oslo to Norway, who was living in Brooklyn. And she decided to move back over to that area because she lived there for 10 years or so, thought she'd have a better chance of earning a living to raise her daughter. So they booked passage to New York. And Ronvald was to pick them at the dock after they landed in New York City, but instead he was confused about the date for some reason and didn't show up. So I have a passage from a biography that my mother wrote in the high school paper when she talks about coming to New York. And she said, beautiful coming into the New York Harbor in a steamer. The first thing I could see was the Statue of Liberty on the left. Further in, I saw Ellis Island, which I came to know very well later in the day. It's a very beautiful sight, the shrubbery and the trees and the big brick buildings, but oh, it was terrible inside. At least it was for us. When we landed in New York, we were sent to Ellis Island because her uncle had forgotten to show up to pick them up and sponsor. They had to have sponsors to get off the ship easily rather than go through the hardcore Ellis Island immigration. And so they were put into housing there, and they were ushered into behind iron gates, and they slammed the gates closed. It just felt like she was in a prison. There were all nationalities there, Romanians and Hungarians, and some people were claiming they were dirty, wrapped in soiled shawls and such, and dirty children running around. When they were eating, or rather trying to eat, the people were crowded around them, and some were eating greasy food with their fingers, and it seemed like they weren't enjoying it. You know, it just wasn't the lifestyle she was used to. And so that night, they had to sleep there in like jail cells with bunks 5 high, long each wall, and try to sleep with all the people around them. But unfortunately, the next day, the uncle showed up and was able to get them released from Ellis Island so they could come into the community there. But this she wrote when she was about 17 years old, and that occurred when she was about 6, so it really stuck with her. The sense of coming in as an immigrant. It was not as easy as they hoped. But they stayed with Emily's brother and his wife, Julia, in Sheepshead Bay, actually, is where they ended up at, in the New York area. And they, as they were staying there for a while, Emily found work and Irma started a school. And Emily's brother's wife, Julia, had a brother living in Kirkland, of all places. He had moved when he had been whaling in Norway. He had eventually taken a job on a Standard Oil freighter and got to New York. And from there, he got another job with another whaling company, Tai Whaling, that took him to San Francisco. And while in San Francisco, that was in 1908, and by 1917, he got a job with American Pacific Whaling Company, which after the locks that they were put in were headquartered in Big Bower Bay, Bellevue. So he ended up going whaling back and forth for years, and then eventually made his way to Kirkland, where he bought this little house on the first hill. And it was a little 700 square foot house. I think there were 2 or 2.3 acre lots that the little mini farms were being sold as all around the Lewis Hill area. And it was just a little 2-bedroom place, living room, kitchen, outhouse, and a lot of acreage. And outbuildings were there for rabbits and chickens, and they had that fenced off. And so Julia decided it was now about 1921 or so, and he needed a wife. He was in his 40s and never married. So she got communication going between Emily and Frank. I guess they liked each other well enough in their letters, and Emily decided to risk the adventure. She'd already traveled from Norway twice on her own. What's going across the United States to meet a stranger? So she and Emily climbed on a train in New York and came across to Chicago and Minnesota and to King Street Station in Seattle, but from where they had, I think Frank met them there. You have to wonder, you know, they never met each other and meeting each other like that, and back then it was not as easy.
What year was it?
This was around 1921. So they took the train to King Street Station, and then from there they had to take a trolley down to Madison. 2 miles up from downtown Kirkland. That was no big deal to him. Just start going. So Emily and Ernest and Frank all had to hike up Piccadilly up to Rose Hill to 126 and 90th, which is a hike after you've traveled cross country.
A lot of stuff, too.
Yeah, I don't know how they got the stuff, whether they had that brought up a day or two later, but they must have taken some minimal things with them. Probably their train cases or something. Yeah, I know she brought belongings with her, because I still have some of her glassware that she brought from Norway and things like that. So I know that there were belongings to be dealt with. So anyway, she kind of going, uh-oh, what I get myself into, this is a little rough here. When you mentioned she lived in Oslo and New York City, she was used to what were considered modern services there with trolleys and stores locally available and stuff to survive with. But I guess it was just a few months later she talked Frank into getting the car. And he never drove, but she hadn't driven before, but there was a lady up the street that did drive and taught her how to drive. So from then on, she was a woman in control and could get to the services a little bit more readily. But here's Emily and Frank. I know they've been together a few years. And these are pictures of the boat that Frank worked on for whaling. This is, I can't read without my glasses on. This is one of them at the Mayflower facility in Munich. I think this might, some of the pictures I have on this should have been at this might be him. I can't tell for sure. But this is Irma as she grew up. She was probably about 15 or so here. And Frank, her younger sister Frances, and Frank that were Frank's kids. Or the picture too. Over here, I'm sorry about some room, I lined up the wrong way for this type of presentation. But here's Emily when she first, in her first winter in Kirkland at that same house that's over there. And then the following spring when she's pregnant with her first daughter, Frances, with Frank. And then here's Emily and her dad and the baby Frances after she was born. And Emily must have had a thing about boats because most of the pictures my mom and she never had big boats in her hair. But my mom, when she was maybe 5 years old, I think this was still in Norway. And they were walking to the Rose Hill School. So shortly after the Yashir, my mom started the second grade down there. She didn't speak really good English, but they said they'd give her a try in second grade, and she did all right. So this is her and then some of her school chums. They'd come up to her house for some type of festivity, I don't know what. And then here's another the house where the kids as they're growing a little bit older. Bob, you were just mentioning about the pilings at the Juanita Beach. This is from looking at the age of my mom and her brother and sister. This is about 1925, and this is part of Juanita Beach. All the pilings behind it, they're right here in the center. And this is the same beach approximately, Juanita Beach, but this is the mid-1950s. I think that's me there, so the view has changed a little bit. The pilings. This one, so probably around 1928 with my mom and her sister there. But Frank was always gone during the summertime, so never see, or seldom see any pictures of Frank during the spring or the summertime because he was always up whaling. It was a good career. He actually was able to earn enough that they bought a rental house across the street from their home and another rental house in Magnolia area of Seattle. And so one of his cohorts in the whaling business, when he was still single, told him, says, don't just blow your money and go drink or whatever, you know, invest in property. That's what will make things work for you as you get older.
What did he do in the off season?
He sat, stayed at home. They had fruit trees and very huge strawberry fields, raspberry fields, and he attended the gardens a lot there and they had rabbits and chickens and such he helped with. But the kids mostly took care of the rabbits and chickens, I think, when they were, as they grew older. He'd make things like, here's a picture of Emily with sitting in a little branch bench that he had made. And he was quite the craftsman, very, very skilled with his hands. And he'd do a variety of different creative things like that. But it was cute after Emily had entered not to live with him. and early 60s, and our house was still on the property.
Really?
It was just that wide and jacked. But he just said, go out there for a little quiet, uninterrupted rest. But it was a wonderful place that they lived in, because the house had fruit trees all around, and just so much produce to play with and stuff. And talking about, as David talks about people bringing him treasures from their homes and stuff for the archives, just a few months ago, my sister was moving the last of her belongings. She's moved about five times, but she had a box to put her son's, and he was selling his home. And she went through this one box, and there was one of those old journals, the gray fabric-covered journals with the white pages inside. And in my mom's writing, there was a listing of all these various pounds of cherries they'd sold for a few pennies a pound. And a lot of them were 5 pounds, 6 pounds, whatever. A lot of them went to Furbush, though, who had a cannery around here. And I was amazed, the total amount of the poundage was like over 1,100 pounds of cherries they'd sold in one season. I thought, that was a lot of cherries. I think we only had one or two trees. But it's interesting because that was a very old record.
Yeah.
And actually, there are recipes and everything else in the same book, which they just travel, you know, just something that kept you can carry along from move to move that my sister had. And you find these little tidbits of information that you aren't even aware of any importance for a long time. And you start putting together, wait a minute, that's that was monetary, at least in their family, helped provide them things that they'd have to buy them by selling the cherries from the trees. And they did have a lot of fruit, and they did sell orcam themselves, you know, they'd sell it to other people, so made for a nice life. And Rose Hill was that way substantially, even if like Bill and your family, there's a lot of crops and stuff on there, fruits and things. And Charlotte Ray Sandwich talked about that.
Yes, and where the cannery you talked about?
I don't know where the cannery was located. It's a Furbush family, Mr. and Mrs. Furbush. But I don't know where it was, somewhere in Furbush, but still there.
Yeah.
It's not the same location as the Santa Can.
No,
no.
Yeah, I remember that. The name is familiar, but I can't remember where it was. It was small, it wasn't very big.
Yeah,
you know.
I don't know, they sold it. I think Furbush must have sold it to retail or something like that. So it just made use of the produce that was available. And then, this is the car my grandmother bought I think this is a 36 Ford. One of you guys might correct me. I know the last car she bought was a 36 Ford. I think this was older than that. I'm not sure. But as their years went along, as I showed you, the kids when they were young and they grew up, eventually they all stayed in the community. And like I said, she mentioned. Well, first of all, here's Frank and his son Ernie as they grow up, and sister or daughter Frances, and then her husband Bud Turner, and then my father Steve, and mother or Ross Stevens. A lot of people call him Steve back then, and my mother Erna, and my older sister Janet. So that would be about 1946. And so it's still in the family yard. And 90% of the photos of my family members from those years were taken either on the side of that house, the front of that house, or behind the house. They were all just in that yard. My grandmother was usually taking the pictures of, and so she saw them in them. But I have a picture up here of my mother at age 16 in 1929, and then my father at age 16 in 1919, he was almost 10 years older than her. He and my mom met because he was renting the house across the street that they owned. When he was, I think she was 19 and he was 15. He was the youngest of seven children in his family, and I guess he was getting on his mom's nerves. He left school in the eighth grade, and she signed him into the Navy and said he was 18. You're out of here. Well, I don't want him. Eventually went back to Wyoming and got out of the Navy, but he ended up back out in Seattle and met Israel. My aunt used to tell stories. He, at one point, he moved to a couple other houses in that neighborhood, and he used to walk up and pick wild roses or roses from the arbor around the house of his residence and bring them on the bouquets and such. So it was kind of a sweet little thing to never think about. So it was eventually in 1936 they got married when she was 22 and he was about there, almost 32. And then in 1944, the picture of them with my older sister, Janet. Then in, this is 1949, this is just after my christening. I'm the baby then, and she's a little older. And then this is probably around, I think it was probably around 1956. Yeah, so the generations just go keep growing older. This is my mom and dad in 1936, is about the time they got married. And it's funny because this is the same front porch that you see here, but the roses have grown.
Wow.
They did, they built over the whole structure there. And so it's fun to watch through the years as the gardening changes, the plant growth is greater. I have a photo somewhere I didn't quite find that just shows the house sitting up on this little bit of the hill with a flagpole. There's no landscaping. That's when Frank was there by himself. He didn't have landscaping. He just had a house to live in. But anyway, it's just fun. That's not where my family came from, how they got here. Some of us are still here. Francis is living in a Cascade Vista, has problems with Alzheimer's now. My brother Ernie, he's about 14 months younger than her. He's living home for stuff just behind this house. They split the property when their father passed away, and his sister had kept this part, and he came to the wife who's away and built him one, so he's there, but he's suffering from Alzheimer's too. So the rest of them have passed on. But it's cute, Francis and Bud met each other at a box social. They sort of knew each other from high school, but they never dated each other. He really wanted to date her, but for some reason he was shy. So there was a box social coming up that his mother got involved and arranged the boxes so that Bud would be sure to be able to buy her box dinner so that they could have a date that evening. They were together from then on for about 55 years, so it worked.
Some history that is being lost with the box socials.
Uh-huh.
Because my family has the same history.
Yeah.
They would bring a lunch in and we'd get on it.
Oh, that's cool.
And it was a fundraiser. We did more church for an organization.
Yeah.
And it was a very sweet thing. It's kind of,
very
kind of it set up. Yeah, so you had
never heard
of
it. See,
and I
was
how
a youngster. Do you know what? Is it an interesting? How many people in here are really descent or Scandinavian descent? I don't know if you all know this, but I did a really big program at the school last year. Did you know that this area in particular, the western part of our state, has the largest group of Scandinavian Nordic folks in the world outside the Nordic countries?
Mm-hmm.
The largest population, and the migration was pretty much kind of like what your family did, but a lot of them didn't go to New York, but skipped and went to like Minnesota, Wisconsin, because I'm Scandinavian.
Yes.
I have a lot of them. Because it reminded them of home or Canada, and then they just thought, we're out of here. And they all came to Washington. I mean, it wasn't just like Oregon or Idaho, it was Washington. And it was
so much of balance over there.
And even today, there's still migrating here. They don't go to New York.
and my Norwegian relatives came. Because they flocked in, they just landed in New York City. We're out here, ended up in Minnesota, thought, I don't know about that. And the railroad brought them
up. Cold.
We need to know the history too of how they really didn't come here.
What transportation?
No. How, why in Minnesota? Why did the Norwegians end up in Minnesota? Because that is where they went. And it is because over in, they have this country and they need to settle it. And so they had reps that would go to the country. And so they'd go to Germany, they would go to Ireland, they would go to England. And they went to Norway. And that group that went to Norway sold them on homesteading Minnesota and Wisconsin. And you didn't come here by yourself. You come with family.
Right.
And so, usually there was a feeler that came out and another was would follow. But that's how they got settled. It wasn't by accident. It was very, very much a commercial thing. This was a country that needed some people. And they ended up in Red Valley Field, and that's why we ended up with, and also, I have roots.
Well, a lot of it too was, it was the kind of work they were accustomed to.
Right.
It was lumber.
Lumber
and fishing.
Oh, yeah. Woodwork. Yeah, yes. It's just, there were trees in Venice.
Yeah, there were trees here.
I saw this and it reminded me so much of him and his whaling days. And I just bought it, and his library's on, has the same cap, he looks at his pictures, same mustache, he had a little pipe hanging out of his mouth, he always had a pipe, he'll, you know, just, that was my grandfather. I painted, yeah.
That's great.
Oh, thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah. But it was just so fun, because it, I really didn't know, my grandmother passed away, in fact, when I was about three, I think it was in 51 or 52, she passed away. And so I was about 3 years old when she passed, and my grandfather's around till I was about 15. And then my grandparents on the other side I never met and such, so he was the only one I really knew, and it was just kind of nice.
Did you ever learn to drive a car?
I don't think so.
Boy, he was definitely an old world.
Yeah. As he got older, his Alzheimer's, or they called dementia back then, kicked in. His son Ernie and Ernie's wife moved in with their two children, and I used to go down and babysit their two children, and grandpa sometimes when I was a teenager, and he was always wanting to walk me home, and he was going to walk down to the whaling docks, and sometimes if nobody was there, he'd go down to the whaling docks, or to the shipyards, because when they closed whaling down in 1939, I think it was, after that he went to work at the shipyards. Well, between whaling and shipyards, he was just used to being near the water and stuff. He just didn't like being tied down to being an old man at home with nothing to do.
What was his full name?
Frank Christian. Well, his real name is Ferdinand Severin Christian's son. And I think there was a martini in the middle somewhere there too. But he called himself Frank. And in whaling circles, just like I mentioned my dad's name, what I mentioned him as being Steve. Well, Ross Stevens, a lot of people call him Steve. Well, Frank Christian's, a lot of people call him Christy, I guess, in the homes and stuff. Yeah, and there was.
Now, what was your father's side, Stevens? What's that? Do you know?
English, Dutch, something like that. His family came to this country back in the 1600s originally. Well, they might have, I can't remember. I think it was one of the Mayflower. I've been told by several women. This family, like, during the DAR, if I wanted to. But, the 1600s, and there were some came from England and some came from France. I think it's more English.
What was his job in the shipyard?
I don't know. There again, it's those things you don't think to ask. Oh, you work in the shipyards. But in those papers that we got a couple of years ago, or last year, whenever it was, from the shipyards, it looked like my grandfather might have been in one of the photos.
I've got a couple of those photos. How long did he work there?
Oh, well, probably till they wore it over, I would guess.
Yeah, my grandpa did too.
My mother and dad both did.
Yeah. Oh, okay. And then as I was mentioning, my grandmother learned to drive from this, I wish I could remember the girl's name, Amy McCurdy, I think her name was, of the street corner. Well, next door to this Amy McCurdy was the old screen star named Milbury Taylor. She used to teach acting lessons to Mary Pickford and Harold Lloyd.
Yeah, she was a really close friend with Harold Lloyd's wife.
Yeah.
And Harold Lloyd's wife used to talk. I always wanted to find if Harold Lloyd ever came up here. But
well, she used to teach him.
Yeah, she used to teach him, right? Yeah. But I never came across any hard evidence that Harold Lloyd was in her. But I know it's like.
Yeah.
He liked to invite him. Mile from the house.
did love that track, and it passed away from a previous writer. No, that was very strange. Frank died 15 years later, once of all that time, Michigan was there. They had a good life together. He was gone 6 months of the year. She used to make, in the spring, when she was, when the kids were home after birth, she'd make dandelion wines, dandelions out of the earth and make it and such. And probably started with my river over. She has
to do that.
Yeah. class just to brush up. And she said, oh no, I know I'll be able to speak it, no problem. I can dream in Norwegian. And we got there, and number one, in the 1920s somewhere, they officially changed their language somewhat. It either was more like Swedish, and now it was more like old Norwegian, or vice versa. But, so they changed the language, so it was a little different, but she was able to understand her aunt perfectly, who spoke the old, could speak the old Norwegian still, and, but she couldn't respond to her in Norwegian, she had to answer in English, and my cousins fortunately could speak English, so that was fun. It was a shock to her that she was able to adapt back. But in fact, when my mom came to Kirkland, she and I think Emily, her mother, could speak English pretty well, but they sent my mom to elocution classes for 2 years to wipe out any trace of the Norwegian accent, because she didn't want to be considered a foreigner. Right. Yeah. And even after she married Ross in 1936, they moved back to Wyoming for about, I think they were there about 4 years, 4 or 5 years, and they'd go into restaurants or various businesses there, and they'd have signs that say, we don't serve foreigners, and things like that, so she had to be very careful about seeing English or American, not Norwegian at all.
Oh.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Actually, she didn't have any accent when I grew up, but there again, the new week.
The breeze out.
Yeah. Anyway, I would suggest that each and every one of you that you spend some time either writing down your personal history or sharing it with your family and stuff.
Well, the best way to do it is like a mind found. I have a sister who digs all the stuff up and meets it first. She does all the work.
Well, that's nice.
She's been really digging deep. We did just 3 years, 2 or 4 years ago, right about the time, I'm not sure about security. My dad passed away. We finally popped open. We didn't know anything. He didn't know anything about, in generations past.
Mm-hmm.
And thanks to the internet, I put out some queries, made that one. Mm-hmm. My sisters jumped on it. We found traces back to the 1600s.
Mm-hmm.
And we found relatives, in fact, my sister met up with one that was kind of eerie. See, part of the reason was it was another black sheep situation where the husband left, ditched the family. And this was, he truly disappeared. We had no idea what happened. He came out here. I know where the gold rush. But anyway, my sister met up in Arizona with one from the other side of the family. So this is a couple generations back when the split occurred.
Mm-hmm.
And she pulled out photos of, her family. And there were some photos of people from the 1800s, and it looked just like my dad. It was really uncanny. Like, oh, that's it is. I mean, just like a photo taking only degrees even more. It was like, okay, we know they're relatives,
I went to a family reunion in 1983 in Long Beach, California, with Stephen's family. And as I mentioned, most of them are from the Illinois area originally. And my father passed away in 1973. So I walked into this reunion, and half the men there looked like my dad. Maybe they were taller, maybe they were shorter, maybe they were a little heavier, maybe they were thinner. They had the same hair, the same facial shape, the eyes were all the same. Maybe their faces were a little longer, but it was the same silver hair, same.
Yeah.
It was just, I don't see those men are. A lot of these, there was much smaller photos just to get a little Highway to the northeast, 102nd and 126th, so we didn't move very far. I didn't move very far. They were at 90th, so kind of have everyone 10 blocks covered.
You really went north, didn't you?
Yeah. Well, it's too cold to last.
How many blocks did you see? You moved from your house? From your original?
I grew up on Northeast 80th and 126th. I now live at Northeast 102nd and 126th. 22 blocks.
Oh, Patrick is closer then. He's only like 6 blocks.
Yeah, he grew up. But my grandparents' house is halfway in between those two locations. All by chance. Just by chance.
Well, thank you everybody for coming. We found out some things about Nancy that we didn't know. City Hall for that centennial thing, and when they get back.
Thank you, Nancy.